Well, hello, friends. Here we are. We're back at it again. Yes, Mike Carlucci's The Bottom Line is on the air. Good to have you aboard, and it is going to be a great show. We are in the midst of making a big decision here for our 2020 year. Yes, indeed. Big decision coming up to make, and we got all kinds of things to talk about. Politics galore. Yes, indeed. And of course, when you're talking politics, you got to bring him in. He's the man of men, the king of kings. Here he is, Mr. Political Activist, the king of libertarians as well. It is Richard Boddie. Hello, my friend. How are you doing?
I'm the greatest of all time. I'm a Joe Frazier. I'm well, thank you.
Very, very good. You look good as always. By the way, this particular episode brought to you by the good folks of Cholula Hot Sauce. Thank you so much for sponsoring this episode. And also we're sponsored by, of course, Papa Carlucci's. Aha, Papa Carlucci's pasta sauce. Gravy, if you will. Old style pasta sauce. Papa Carlucci. All right, here we go. Lots of things on the table, Mr. Richard Boddie. So good of you to spend some time with us there. And I see, of course, we're going for Joe Jorgensen 2020 with not Spike Owen, but Spike Cohen as the VP. And we'll talk more about that in just a few seconds. But let's just jump into a few things here. I want to kind of stick to a list here, if you will. The vice presidential debate, of course, was a few weeks ago, and it was pretty nice and calm. You had Mike Pence going up against Kamala Harris. And the star of the debate was it David Hedison or was it Jeff Goldblum as the fly? I mean, fill us in on that. What did you think about that VP debate?
I thought it was better than the presidential debate. I thought the characters looked better, too. Because Pence, not so much, but Kamala, wow. Hey, what can I tell you? It's the best thing she's got going for her. Because as a former prosecutor who's trying to switch and become a progressive Black Lives Matter person, she's got a lot of garbage to get rid of. But it was a much better debate than the other fools' ridiculous thing of the orange face and my law school counterpart Joe Biden.
Yeah, your buddy that for some do say that he was on the bottom of the totem pole when it comes to his class rating. Yes,
he did place last in his class.
Yes,
class of 1968, Syracuse University College of Law.
Right.
Whatever you can call a valedictorian at the other end, he was it.
So we already chatted about the first debate, and now the second debate was a big show on Thursday, a lot better than the first one. The first one was such a farcical gathering of fools. If it was a football game, it would have been a 3-3 tie when both coaches running off the field fighting each other in a big brawl, and they canceled the game. Kind of like some of those old high school coaches or baseball coaches always fight sometimes in Little League. That's what it seemed to be, just a disaster, if you want to use one of Trump's words. But this second one, nice and calm, good moderator, keeping things in control. Some say, though, maybe one or the other had a little bit more than the 2 minutes allotted. And it was a total in reverse, if you will, or a little more controlled. And it just seemed like it was a heck of a lot better.
As far as the show part goes, but as far as the substance, both of them are equivocators, to be nice. Both of them say things that aren't true. Both of them live by constantly being politicians who support whatever their game plan is. And it has gotten old to the point where even people in either party are saying, okay, time out. Let's get to some real issues and see if we can have some sort of a compromise here, because it's craziness that's going to get out of hand, I project.
Well, some say that Trump kicked butt and did very well and won the debate. There's some other people that say that Biden won the debate. talking to a handful of people on the sidelines, they said it was a 14-14 tie. If this was a football game, it was a 14-14 tie. Midway into the fourth quarter, Trump throws a 50-yard TD pass to take the lead 21-14. And then on the ensuing kickoff, and then after the first play after the kickoff, Biden fumbles the ball. Trump's team recovers, scores on a 10-yard touchdown pass, 28-14. And then a desperation, a couple minutes to go, Biden throws a long bomb that gets intercepted. It's run back for a touchdown. So some are saying Trump won that debate 35-14.
Yeah, that I have a problem with any person saying either of those won the debate because I was a debater in college here at Bucknell. Yes.
Yes.
I was a moot court honors person at Syracuse Law School. And there are certain parameters that are set up that don't exist on TV and political races with the two national parties, though they make people believe it's a debate. So I personally don't buy into what they even call the damn thing. Mm-hmm. But as far as who won, and both lost, because I don't think a single Trump person switched to Biden as far as their vote's going to go. Mm-hmm. I know no person who is a Biden person is going to switch to Trump. So all it is a hype to keep people's mind off of what's really going on. Mm. Two things that are really going on. The person who's behind me on this screen should have been in that debate.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
The game that's played. Here's a person who is a part of the third largest political party in this country, who should have been in debates because she's on the ballot in every single state in this country, plus D.C. and Puerto Rico, and nobody knows it. In the article I wrote for the Southern California News Group in the editorial section or in the opinion section on Sunday, I wrote an article on this very thing. And the term I use, you heard me use it, it's people saying, well, who is this Joe Jorgensen and why haven't I heard about him? Well, there you go.
Yep, that's right.
It's Joanne is her name. She was born with. She goes by Joe as a professor at Clemson University, a psychologist, doctor, PhD in psychology. She's been involved with the American with the Libertarian Party since, oh golly, at least 1992, because when we saw each other in Anaheim two Sundays ago, she was going through the crowd at this brewery, Anaheim Brewery, whatever, and she got to me and she said, "Carpe diem." And she got that because her first libertarian convention that she ever attended, a national convention, was when I was running for the presidential nomination for the Libertarian Party back in 1991 for the 1992 nomination.
Absolutely.
And she remembered me from then. So she's been involved. She was on the ticket with Harry Brown. So it was Harry Brown and Joe Jorgensen. Now you go all these years forward, what, 24 years or whatever, my math is slow right now, and she's the VP, she's the presidential candidate, and she won that back in May at the National Libertarian Party Convention, even though it was COVID shut down and it was doing it like this and everything else. She should have gotten at least an invitation to speak at the debates, because the parameters set up by the debate committee are that if you have at least 5 or 15% or whatever in five different polls, magazine polls or whatever, you're qualified. Well, she qualified in all five and they disappeared. All of a sudden, all those polls just disappeared. So it says, we really don't want any competition, because if the public, if the mass of American people realize they do have a choice, a lot of the foolishness that we see would be gone. Mm-hmm. There would be some real consideration of how we develop public policy. But this is absent. And what we have here with Biden and Trump is like, no matter who wins the presidential race this time, it's going to be real chaos afterwards. There's going to be probably insurrection because it's been going on since George Floyd. But whoever wins, it's sort of like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic.
Well, it seems like on the debate, this final debate, there was a lot of you-know-what being slinged in the air, the S-H-I-T. And it seemed like who lied the most? I mean, they are the Washington Liars, which I think that should be the name of the new of the Washington. Yeah, no more Washington Redskins. It should be the Washington Liars. But it seemed like, I don't know, talking to a few people, like I said, on the sidelines, that Biden had a little bit, had more lies than Trump, right. And especially the situation with fracking. He was caught in the middle of that and said, check the video. And everybody have seen numerous videos, and he's trying to do it, do a little tap dance saying he didn't really mean that. He was trying to say it in a different, word, different context about fracking and so on. So could that have changed people's view, this entire debate, on if they were actually thinking they were on the fence about, leaning toward Biden? Do you think after this debate, maybe people now are going back to Trump?
If they haven't made up their minds already and they are caught between Trump and Biden, and if those are people's choices, there is a small percentage of people, obviously, who have not made up their minds and will vote for one of those two, either by a coin flip or by some lie or by a mistake or whatever.
Well, and this Hunter Biden situation, too, could kind of be like what Hillary had to deal with the emails and the Benghazi, that kind of thing in 2016. Now we're 2020, and now this Hunter Biden thing has put a horrible drape on Joe's, his father's campaign. So what do you think? That you think that might be a deciding factor? You think it will?
No, because I'll say the Russians did that too.
They're damn right.
The whole thing is set up to make sure that one of those two people get elected president. I think what's going to happen is that Trump's going to win in a landslide. And the reason I say that, for two reasons. Having taught political science for many years, I know that incumbents win at about 90 to 98%, depending upon what the office is. Mm-hmm. The House of Representatives about 90. And the U.S. Senate's about 95. U.S. Presidency, it's about 99.3 or something like that. Mm. If you're the president and you don't die, or you don't quit, or you don't get kicked out, you're going to win. Now, in 2016, Democrats were just totally devastated that Trump won because they just ignored his stupidness. Mm-hmm. And they've had 4 years to lament Trump and this I forget the Trump derangement syndrome.
Yeah.
The whole thing is just, we got to get rid of this guy and everything's going to be all right. You get rid of this guy and you bring in Kamala and Joe Biden. Then you're going to have China running this nation within about 6 months. And you're going to have a police state like you could never dream of. And the entire thing that Marx predicted is going to come to pass. On the other hand, if Trump wins, which I think he will, then you're going to have 4 more years of craziness of not knowing what this guy's doing. And hopefully, behind the scenes, there are rational people in his cabinet who are helping make decisions to save this thing for at least another 4 years. This thing meaning the United States as a free nation that we did know about. But the key is simply this. Most people don't like to be called racist. Most people don't like to argue politics. Most people really don't know what the hell they're talking about when it comes to politics. Exactly. So what's going to happen is there are literally millions of people, many African Americans, also known as black people. There are literally multi-millions of white people who don't want to be in a debate or argument about Trump. But when they go into the voting booth, they're going to vote for the orange-faced joker, because statistical probability, number one. And number two, anybody who checks the progressive side of this ball game says, otherwise, this thing is over within a couple of weeks.
So I'm going to put you on the spot. You've already have said that Trump is going to win this thing, but let me put you on the spot. Do you think it's going to be a landslide or a close one?
Landslide.
Okay. Okay.
I have money on it too. So.
Oh, you got you. So you have a horse in the race. Okay, I get it. I get you.
One of the funniest things, though, my late wife Anne, she would attest to this. She says, if Dick puts money on any bets, it's going to lose. But the same bet where he not to put a cent on it,
yeah,
generally wins. So most likely what I've said already is going to go up in smoke because I bet a friend $100 it's going to win. So most likely we're going to have Biden and he'll quit and Kamala will become president. And before that, they'll institute the Omnibus Crime Act with FEMA running the detention centers. And this whole thing is gone awry because most people would never dream that we would be doing things that we are now or be in the position we are today.
Yeah.
Even a year ago, they would never think that we would have, like in the movie V for Vendetta, that virus would have come and that people would be told to stay in their homes. That just wouldn't appear in a brain, especially if you knew anything about the flu epidemic of 1918, which was a bit more serious than this one.
Yeah, without a doubt.
They don't want you to know that. Yeah. But they didn't shut the economy down. They didn't shut they didn't make executive decisions as to what's an essential business then. And that, my friends, is one of the problems we face. The politicians have destroyed the economy for your children and your grandchildren, which makes it, if you study any history at all, makes it more probable that what we knew as the United States and its ability to be a leader in the world is pretty well over with, going back to about March 17th, 2020. That's St. Patrick's Day. That's the day everything said, everything shut down, and you got to stay home, except for the businesses that the people in power want to keep open. It makes no sense to me why certain restaurants would be closed or hairdressers would be closed, but marijuana stores are still open.
You know what I mean? And they're selling liquor like crazy. Beer sales are up. Booze is skyrocketing. And you brought up a point about certain people that are on the fence, or if they're not on the fence, they pretty much like Trump, or even if they don't like him, or they do like Biden. And they may say they like Biden, but they're not going to vote for Biden. They're going to vote for Trump because they don't want anybody to know. Now, I know the Hollywood group, the Hollywood crowd is pro-liberal always. There is always a handful or more that are conservative and Republican, but they just don't come out with it because they want to make sure they can work in the business. Mm-hmm. There are some big name stars that don't care if anybody knows they're conservative or vote Republican because they're big time stars and they do their own movies. They don't give a darn. But the ones that are kind of in between, they want to make sure they get hired. They don't piss anybody off. I mean, you could piss off your agent who might be liberal. You could piss off a casting director that's liberal. And you don't want to piss off a producer or director that's liberal because they may want you. But if you don't go with their opinions and their thoughts and feelings, you might be in the unemployment line. So there's tons of those people out there, not just in Hollywood, but in the general population that are probably sit there, don't want to talk about politics. They just do their own business. They stay home, do their, you know, go out and do their thing, but they won't talk politics. But they're the ones that probably, like you said, are going to mark on our ballots. This ballot right here, I did mine already. I'm getting ready to mail it, but they're filling out their ballots and they're going to probably vote for Trump, you know? So we'll see. We'll see here coming up in a few days.
Well, I stopped voting back in 2003. So I sort of was like a guy who was teaching religion, but was an atheist. Mm-hmm. I'm teaching American government, but I'm not voting. The reason I stopped voting was simply that the most basic reason was when they elected Arnold Schwarzenegger of no political background to be the mayor of the largest populated state in the country.
Governor.
I'm done. As if my vote would really make a difference at all. But mm-hmm. just pretending like most people do that my vote is going to be the one that differs. I said, I will never vote again because I don't want the Nuremberg trials of 2065 to come and say that I was a part of this foolishness. Or if I don't pass away before 2021 mm-hmm. and the Nuremberg trials do start for the American political system, they can't blame me for any of this stuff.
Yeah, there you go. Let's talk about Proposition 22 exempts app-based transportation and delivery companies from providing employee benefits to certain drivers, initiative statute. This is the Ubers and the Lyfts and those kinds of freelance gigs, mm-hmm. Things that you have to put together with your 1099s and use all your write-offs to bring your tax down. This is a very touchy one because it also involves, I think we always discussed about the union situation, about being able to have the choice to be in a union or not, or to be a freelance person or get benefits and things like that. What's your take on Proposition 22?
I think it should pass. I think that it says if you're going to exempt in your initial law a dozen different independent contracting professions or jobs, and you stop at the people who deliver the food or the people that you can get into a vehicle with your credit card and go where you want to go, because that big corporation Lyft and the big corporation Uber don't function like a 19th century factory. Is ridiculous. And so they exempted doctors, accountants, they exempted who in their initial legislation. But the bottom line is they're really going after Uber. I forget the one that delivers the food, and Lyft.
Oh, that's DoorDash, I believe.
DoorDash.
Yeah.
And there's one other.
Yeah, there's another one. See, yeah.
They don't like them because basically, they can't. It's like trying to pick up mercury with your fingers. It doesn't really fit the parameters or the old game plan. So they're saying these people aren't getting benefits. Well, if I wanted benefits, I would go to a 40 hour week job. If I want to be able to just make money on the side, if I want to do it legally, mm-hmm. I can drive people around in my car. And it's a 21st century concept because it's using handheld devices and it's getting people to locations more quickly. And also, Prop 22 gives additional benefits, mileage, I think medical plans, a few other things that they were hollering about people don't get with Uber and Lyft. Mm-hmm. They do now. So if 22 passes, it will also be an exception to the AB5 law that in effect has done away with independent contractors in the state of California. Mm-hmm. And if it does pass, mm-hmm. And if it doesn't pass, that means that you'll have to wait for the cab again, and you'll have to
and pay higher prices, because that's the thing. The cabs rip you off. At least with the Uber and the Lyft, there's a set price, and you know going in how much right. it's going to cost. You can drive around the block with a cab, and he can charge you $10. You know,
plus you can't use your credit card.
Exactly.
Use modern technology with the cab.
Yeah, there's some cab drivers allow credit cards, but they charge you a service fee, as in Uber and Lyft. They just, boom, $10 cash. And if you want a tip, you have the choice. If you don't want it, it's no big deal. By the way, the other delivery service besides DoorDash is Postmates. That's the other one. Now, Postmates is having an issue. I've heard people that are doing some freelance with Postmates, but they're, I don't know if they're getting ready to go bankrupt. They're not paying people on time. So I think some people are very upset about that. I think DoorDash, though, is probably thumbs up and doing very well. So Prop 22, yes or no, that is a tough one. But the freelancers, you know, that's to their benefit. And the choice to, you know, do the freelance. And we called it moonlighting, you know, like bartending at night. Some people have a 40-hour work week. They go work at a bar, you know, moonlighting, getting some extra cash. Same thing. They want to get some extra cash, driving around, picking people up, delivering food, delivering supplies. There's besides food, there's some other companies, delivery services that drop off certain mail and things like that. So it'll be interesting to see what happens on that election night for those propositions. So great. Rich, you did a great job there covering that stuff. I knew you would. Just a couple of quick things here before we roll out with the Trump and Biden election coming up on Tuesday, November 3rd. Now, 60 Minutes had a little issue, I guess, Leslie Stahl, I think that's her name from CBS, 60 Minutes, one of the interviewers. She had a nice, easy, basic Joe Biden question and answer get together. And then I believe the Trump get together got a little hostile. He said, hey, you're asking me tough questions and you're so easy on Biden, but you're really tough on me. And I think he actually walked out of the interview. And I think they had to edit it together and piece it together. I think it was like 45 minutes worth of info. And only, I think, close to 25 minutes actually aired, I believe. I didn't get a chance to see the interview yet. So a little hostile thing there. You know, Trump's still thinking everybody hates him and the whole thing. And which is true in a sense. You can put together polls and people will say that. And now I want to talk about Pelosi and Wolf Blitzer. They had a little go at it there on CNN. He had asked her, why are we holding up the stimulus package while people are struggling at home, trying to put food on the table, put gas in their tanks and trying to get things going there. They need money. And she, it was interesting, a one-on-one thing. And they went at it. And I didn't know for years that Wolf Blitzer was a conservative. I thought he was a libertarian at most or liberal. And I was shocked that they said he's a conservative. And I think he's got to be the only one over there at CNN, right?
Yeah.
So it's interesting. So what's your take on that? Of course, Pelosi caught some heat, you know, many weeks ago. She went into that beauty parlor to get her hair done in San Francisco. And that was a big social media craze. And, you know.
I find that the people who are running the show, whether it's in Congress or whether it's Pelosi as Speaker of the House, Schumer, AOC on the Democrat or the progressive side, mm-hmm. This guy who was the Speaker of the House, the Senate Majority Leader, Republicans and all of those. I find all of those kind of people to be bad people. These are people who don't have a job and they don't go to work and they make their money by acting like they're doing something for their public or for their constituents. And the constituents get all excited about it now because if it's blue against red, which is backwards, by the way, you ever hear of a red progressive? A blue progressive? Get out of here. That's red. Communist, socialist, progressive.
Yeah, the big red, yes.
They got that backwards, by the way.
The Red Army, yes.
And the blue guys are Republicans. The anal retentive people who are the New England Yankee type people are blue, but they got it backwards. Yeah. But it's a game. And the game, Jesse Ventura said it a few years ago. I think he even wrote a book about it. He said it's like professional wrestling. There are very few people who are playing that game who I respect. And even those who I used to respect at times, they would fall prey to just being caricatures of politicians who really don't give a damn about their constituents. They're more concerned about themselves. So back to your point with Pelosi or Blitzer or anybody else. Pelosi is just doing what she's paid to do, and that's to be upset with Trump people. Yeah. The Trump people are doing what they're paid to do, and that's to stay with the crazy orange guy. Because if they don't, they have to go and get a real job.
Yeah.
The economy is not going to allow for too many more real jobs to exist when you cut a third of the entire GNP and the jobs, a third, don't exist. That existed just a year ago. And my take on it is this. When you have anything over $20 trillion in debt for a nation that has not cut back on anything, Trump ain't cutting back on nothing. The progressives want to spend more. Joe Biden wants to spend more. It's $27 trillion, I guess, now. They didn't put through the new stimulus package because it would make it $30 trillion in the hole. And you can't do that as an individual, and you can't do that as a company. The real pandemic is not a virus. The real pandemic is the debt that's going to collapse this whole nation.
Good point. There's
a thing I do in a speech, and the speeches, I end speeches often with, it's not historically proven to be really exist, but it maybe is. And it says a democracy cannot exist as a permanent form of government. It can only exist until the voters discover that they can vote themselves largesse from the public treasury, with the result that the public always votes for the person promising the most benefits from the public treasury, with the result that a democracy always collapses over loose fiscal policy, always followed by a dictatorship, and it proceeds through the following steps: from bondage to spiritual faith, from spiritual faith to great courage, from great courage to liberty, from liberty to abundance, from abundance to selfishness, from selfishness to complacency. Where are we? From complacency to dependency, and from dependency back again to bondage. We're close. The American empire is in jeopardy.
Wow. Well, one quick note I'm going to send out, since we're talking about Wolf Blitzer from CNN. Now, Van Jones from CNN, I'm not sure if you're a fan of his or not, but he's been very critical with Trump for many, many years. But there is rumor that he kind of stepped in. He's actually backed him up on a few things over the years. And he was quoted the other day saying Trump doesn't get enough credit for the good stuff he has done for the black community. What do you think about that? What's your take on that?
Well, I watched Van Jones for about 8 years, 9 years now. Mm-hmm. And he's gone almost the same path that I went through. Mm-hmm. From socialist, Marxist, progressive, Democrat, to Republican, to libertarian. Van Jones saw Trump function with this whole area of the prisons and said, we have to change the whole approach to prisons, and we have to have some bipartisan cooperation with this. And they put together a whole new legislation that humanizes incarceration. Van Jones was working with Trump people at that point. I was surprised. And Trump signed it, and it became law. At which point, Van Jones was all of a sudden exposed to see that so much of what is pushed on Trump is a lie, not true, or just has to do with his crazy personality. I would not be surprised if in the future, Van Jones crosses over.
You know, Leo Terrell, American civil rights attorney, has also flipped, and he's backing Trump up as well.
I think anybody who's looking at it with the Trump derangement syndrome that has been going on since 2016, you have to wonder why people are so rabidly opposed to Trump. I'm not a Trumper either. But you have to wonder why. And I think the reason is because you can't really buy him off. And also, he is doing some things that have needed to be done on behalf of the United States of America internationally for many, many decades now. So some of the things he's doing are about to save this nation, which is surprising, but maybe for only 4 years or so.
Yeah.
But people who are really using their brain can look up and see, why is Ben Carson still there? Ben Carson has a pretty good reputation of things, that, of helping people as a black baby cardiologist over the years, who came up from the Detroit ghetto, et cetera, who understands the American way, who doesn't buy into Black Lives Matter. He believes all Black Lives Matter.
Dave Clark, Milwaukee County Sheriff, was big in the news. He had a lot of arguments with Don Lemon, as some people call him. He's been a contributor on Fox, and his main argument he's had with the mainstream media is Black Lives Matter. He does not believe in it. He thinks all lives matter, and he is just very upset of people taking shots at cops and other armed forces. And I thought, and he's a big Trump supporter, I thought for sure he would get a job with Donald Trump in his cabinet there, you know, secretary of something, department head of something, but he's disappeared. He retired as the sheriff. But I'm just wondering if Trump will bring him back, if Trump wins the election.
Well, there are so few African-Americans who are Trump people. Dave Clark has made himself known to be one. And if the Donald wins again, I'm sure that Clark would be considered as somebody who might be a part of his cabinet, because he needs all the help he can get with that one, because people call him a racist. I contend he's not. I just think he's a politician who understands yin and yang.
Well, a lot of big decisions to make here in the remaining days until November 3rd. Your prediction is Trump in a landslide. I am still not convinced. I don't know yet. I don't know the feeling. I'll be watching like everybody. Some people just go to bed early and just worry about it until they wake up in the morning. But I like the action. I'll be keeping tabs on all the news networks and things like that. I think it'll be interesting. I do have a gut feeling we're going to have a repeat of 2016. I think the polls are saying the same things they said about Hillary with all those percentages, all those swing states. And as you know, what happened there. And I think we may have a carbon copy of that. So, but it'll be interesting to see what happens. I think this Hunter Biden thing, Joe's son might have a deciding factor on that. I think some people that have not decided yet who they want, they might look at that more trouble from a politician who's a strict politician for 47 years. And, you know, what has he done? That kind of thing. And he's kind of throwing those curveballs out there. I'm against fracking. No, I'm not. You know, that kind of thing. I want to frack. I do not want to frack. You know, I mean, he's can't make up his mind. And if some things come out with Kamala Harris, you know, we have yet to hear all the skeletons from her closet. So maybe those things might pop out here in the next couple of days. Who knows? It'll be interesting, but we do have a choice. By the way, before we finish off here, a lot of people thought my this guy here to the left of me is William Shakespeare. It's actually Christopher Columbus, which I don't think it's called Christopher Columbus Day anymore, right? It's Cristobal Colon is his name, but I think they changed the name of the somewhat holiday.
Yes.
What's it called now?
Indigenous Peoples Day.
There you go, Indigenous Peoples Day. So anyway, nonetheless, Chris Columbus, they're not William Shakespeare. But Richard, I appreciate your time, as we do have, of course, the Decision 2020. For those, make sure you get your ballots in by mail if you have to, or stop by your local places, participants that are helping people with the vote at the libraries, schools, some people's garages. So whatever you got to do to get in there before November 3rd, get your vote. Your vote's very important. Propositions are important. Your local officials are important, certain counties and so forth. Make sure you vote for that. And of course, make the decision, either Donald J. Trump and Mike Pence, or Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, and or might be a better choice, Joe Jorgensen and Spike Cohen.
Yes.
So make the decision and make it count. So Richard Boddie, again, thank you, my friend, for your time. and your energy and your perspective on everything. We always appreciate talking to you. You've been watching Mike Carlucci's The Bottom Line, brought to you by the good folks from Cholula. Cholula hot sauce. This is the kind of hot sauce you can leave in your car in very extreme hot temperatures, up to 120 degrees. It's still going to be fresh, and it's going to feel good on your burrito or taco. So make sure Cholula. And, of course, Papa Carlucci's old-time pasta sauce. Until next time, make sure you must do it daily if you can. Grab that shovel, stick it in the ground, dig it in there, get it up there, dig it in there hard, get it deep, and search and bring up the shovel, and you never know, you'll find the bottom line. Until next time, you guys have a great week, great weekend. Stay healthy, wear your mask if you have to. I got my mask right here. I put it on everywhere I go. It's dark blue. It's New York Yankee blue. Even though I do have a San Francisco Giants one around somewhere, my fashion collection of masks. And then Richard Boddie, what do you got there, my friend? What's that?
That's my favorite doll.
Ah.
Says, sue the bastards.
Sue the bastards. Right on. Yeah, right on. Hey, come on, man. Come on, man, as your buddy Joe would say. Richard, again, thanks for your time, my friend. You be well and be healthy. And everybody out there, be healthy and safe as well. Until next time, thanks for watching Mike Carlucci's The Bottom Line. Remember to go out and vote. Take care, everyone. See you, Richard.
Thank you, Mike.